the home of the Terriers, Wofford College, here in Spartanburg, South Carolina. And they're led by fullback Eric Breitenstein, who leads the nation with 22 touchdowns on the ground. Georgia Southern made the five-hour trek from the state of Georgia, and their quarterback is Jabo Shaw, the transfer from Georgia Tech. Georgia Southern has been here before. They celebrated Christmas at the national championship game six times, and a large contingent has made their way over from Statesboro. Live from Spartanburg, South Carolina, and they are excited for the rematch between Wofford and Georgia Southern. They met on October 19th in a thriller. Wofford won 33-31, but much more at stake today. The winner advances to the semifinals. In fact, the winner will travel to Delaware next Saturday. Hi, everybody. I'm Doug Bell alongside David Diaz Infante. We have a terrific game for you today. The weather is perfect. These teams, Dave, are playing at a very high level. We watched a lot of tape. They are really good right now. And I think what got them to this point really is playing the very tough Southern Conference.
Well, think about the Southern Conference. Three of the eight quarterfinalists come from that conference. It's tough. It's physical. And both these teams know each other well. Should be a great one.
Georgia Southern has returned to the triple option that was made famous by Paul Johnson. Before that, Irk Russell. They're excited. They have the perfect quarterback. He transferred from Georgia Tech, played for Coach Johnson last year. I know you like Jabo Shaw.
Think about the luxury Coach Monken has in terms of having a guy that was trained by Paul Johnson, transferred from Georgia Tech, and then his mentor, he has his quarterback leading his team right now. He's a big reason why Georgia Southern is here today.
How about Wofford? They also run the triple option, but a different look. Sometimes they'll be in the shotgun, a more multiple formation, but the bottom line is they want to get in the hands of their fullback, Eric Breitenstein. He's a hammer.
Well, they lead the nation in rushing, and he's a big reason why they're doing that. He had 178 yards, two touchdowns last. Guy that makes a start their run game up the middle. He's quick-footed. He's got the moves. He's not the fastest guy, but he's got great feet and great vision in the hole. He's a big reason why they're here today.
Well, it's going to be terribly exciting. And check out the fans who made the short trek over from Statesboro, Georgia. It is packed on the Georgia Southern side. They won this thing six times, but not in 10 years.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Our Carolina, our home, our house. We got the rock, we got the roll. It's yep. Gotta be from the time that we kick off to the final whistle. Play your brains out. Yep. Play your brains out.
That's head coach Mike Ayers of Wofford College. He's been here a long time in his 23rd year. The weather could not be better. They were expecting rain, but it's coming later tonight, maybe tomorrow. Temperature right around 50 degrees. Clear skies. It is perfect for football. Now, Mike Ayers, Dave, has been around a long time. He grabbed you yesterday. He's never played the same team in one season before. He wanted to get some advice from you.
Oh, well, that's 40 years of coaching right there, too. And he pulled me over and goes, hey, Dave, you got to tell me, the NFL, you guys play your division opponents twice a year. What is that like? I've never done it before. And I think it's one of those things that really is an advantage. Not a lot of surprises here. To me, that means this game comes down to execution. And none will be more important than for both these teams because it's one and done.
We talked to Coach Ayers yesterday. Now, at the walkthrough, he was very calm and serene, Dave. I heard that pregame talk. Boy, a little different demeanor today from the old coach.
Yeah, I love it. He's old school. It was great talking to him yesterday. He's fired up, wants his team fired up. You're right, really calm yesterday, but today it's for all the marbles. The winner goes on. This is what it's all about right here in the FCS.
Here come the Terriers playing at home. And have come over, not a surprise. Football is a big deal at Georgia Southern.
It sure is. So think of the tradition, six national championships. You think of Irk Russell, you think of Paul Johnson. He's got a huge tradition to live up to. But he brought back the triple option. That's why they're here today, and they've got the quarterback, the right. second half of that defense.
Again, Jeff Munkin worked for Paul Johnson. As for the Terriers of Wofford, pretty simple stuff. You got to get the big guy the football, right, Dave?
Well, that's right. He's got 22 touchdowns on the year. They got to get him going from the pistol formation and the traditional fullback formation as well. And defensively, they've got to recognize the different personnel groupings and formations for Georgia Southern so they don't give up any big plays. Minimal stakes could equate to that.
Georgia Southern won the toss, by the way, and they deferred, so Wofford will receive to start off the game. As for the series, now keep in mind the road team has won the last five meetings, including the game in October in Statesboro when Wofford won a wild one, 33-31. The last four games decided by 11 total points. I tell you what, I'm looking forward to another one of those games, Dave, back and forth, up and down. I think it's going to go down to the final seconds.
Yeah, like it did in October, down to the fourth quarter. The defense of Wofford really stepped up their game when it mattered most. But I tell you what, it's hard to tell which the home team is right now. Georgia Southern fans.
Southern wearing the road white will kick off. And deep for the Terriers, Mike Rucker, the all-time leader in return yards for the Terriers, along with Jeremy Marshall. And Rucker is dangerous. Dave, we talked to the coaches. They think maybe he's the fastest guy on the roster.
Yeah, clearly his fastest guy probably on the field here today. And he's the reason why they will make huge chunks of yardage in the kickoff return game, which really equates to better field position for their offense.
There you see Mike, the speedster, doing some jumping jacks to get warm. Billy Greer boots it away for the Eagles. Slight breeze right behind him, and he's pumped up, and that goes into the end zone. And the Terriers will start here in the quarterfinals from the 20-yard line.
Not a better way than to eliminate the threat of Rucker as a returner than to kick it deep into the end zone.
Again, a year ago, the Terriers were 3-8. It was a rough season, but Mike Ayers knew what he was doing, played a lot of youngsters a year ago, and now most of these guys are back, including quarterback Mitch Allen. 10 victories for the Terriers this season. Those are solid numbers for Allen, who does a great job running this triple option.
Well, he's an intelligent player, and his leadership skills are outstanding.
Allen checking out the defensive alignment of Georgia Southern. The fake to the fullback and the pitch back. Positive yards for Wofford right off the bat. Again, that's Mike Rucker. Let's look at the impact players now for the Terriers.
Well, here's Eric Reitenstein, too. 178 yards, two touchdowns last week, 22 touchdowns on the year. He's the guy that makes that offense go. Brenton Burson, he's the guy. They don't throw the ball much when they do their impact plays. Brent Russell for Georgia Southern, he's the guy that's got to hold up that middle for him.
First pass of the game. Goes for a first down to the outside. Positive play. Brenton Burson, you talked about him, Dave. Big, tall target at 6'4".
Lull you to sleep and try to get something over the top.
Again, getting the signals from the sideline. The center, Trey Johnson, as we watched tapes yesterday, Dave, boy, he really jumped out at me. He was dominant inside for Wofford. Breitenstein, his first carry, hammers it forward right behind Trey Johnson and left guard Pat Illig, who's the biggest player on the field at 6'5", 320.
Yeah, and they get the big man pulling on that when they double-team down on the nose guard. And again, trying to crease that defense early, and they're going right at Brent Russell.
There you see Josh Gebhardt in on that stop. High school running back a year ago. Now the starting defensive end for Georgia Southern. Second down and eight. There you see that wing bone look. That's what Coach Ayers calls it. Pitch to the outside. Close to a first down. That was Donovan Johnson taking the pitch, his first carry. John Stevenson on the stop for Georgia Southern.
And watch the decision making by Mitch Allen. Again, away from motion, a little counter option to the outside. Sits down, great relationship to the pitch, executes it well.
Got a mark a little short of the first down, so we'll bring up the first third down situation today for the Terriers. Third and about 1.5. There's that multiple look from the gun. Reitenstein, you know they'd give it to him. Josh Rowe on the stop. It's hard to bring Reitenstein down with one guy.
Yeah, he's got thick legs, quick feet, and Coach really talked about his vision, his ability to see and feel things.
Jacksonville State broke free late in that game for the touchdown that broke it open for the Terriers. Flag down, left tackle moved a bit.
First down.
That's Dave Epperly, our referee from the Big South Conference. Not the Southern Conference, but the Big South. There's your big Calvin Cantrell. Got a little antsy on that left side, Dave. You know what that's about. You get a little itchy over there, don't you?
I sure do. Then you try to freeze me. See if anyone saw you or not.
First and 15. Here comes the blitz. Breitenstein breaks free. Look at him cover up that football. Dodges a tackler and knocked out of bounds inside the five. Josh Rose saved the touchdown. There is a flag down back at the line of scrimmage. We'll check that flag. Breitenstein, obviously a good receiver as well.
Illegal block in the back. Offense, number 83. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
That's Andrew Young, the wide receiver, and that's going to wipe out a 50-yard play. And that happened right at the line of scrimmage, so it's a spot foul. So, Dave, wow, that was about a 60-yard penalty.
Oh, and that's just an area where Wofford's really made a huge improvement this season. 61 plays of 20-plus yards. Really been a big difference and impact on their offense this year. That one negated by the penalty.
Two straight penalties now for the Terriers. Pulling it out from the gut of the fullback and the pitch back to Donovan Johnson. Cuts back and gets those yards back from the penalty. So it'll bring up second down at about 9. Darius Eubanks on the stop for the Eagles. There you see Carson Hill. He was one of the seniors on the team, by the way. Yesterday there were graduation ceremonies at Georgia Southern on campus. Obviously the football players could not be a part of that. And so the president, Brooks Keel, drove up to the team hotel last night wearing the full garb. And he had graduation ceremonies for Calvin West, Carson Hill, Lee Banks, and Philip Bailey, the team manager. Terrific move by the president, Brooks Keel. He was called for the penalty and now answers back with a grab, Dave.
Watch how this starts from above. Look at the pocket. A junior out of Atlanta for Georgia Southern, and he's a big-time hitter back there. That's a way to absorb the hit, hang on to the football for your ball club.
That went for 28 yards, first and 10. Ball nestled right on the 25 of Georgia Southern. Mitch Allen keeps it himself. Breitenstein knocked down his own guy. Breitenstein just wants to knock people down. He doesn't care who's in front of him.
Yeah, a little mix-up in timing of the motion between Mike Rucker and the fake inside to Breitenstein. A little collision behind the line of scrimmage.
Again, looking to the sidelines. Wade Lang is the longtime offensive coordinator for Wofford. He's been here with Coach Ayers both for 23 seasons. He's been running this triple option every year. Here's the fullback. That was Jeremy Marshall. Brent Russell stood him up. Marshall's first carry of the afternoon. He's pumped up.
You can see that pistol formation, right? Two back slot formation, and they hand it off right inside. Look at the offensive line trying to maintain their blocks. But look at Georgia Southern right there. I think that's number 66, Brent Russell, fighting off the blockers and making that play.
Talk to Brent Pry, the defensive coordinator for Georgia Southern. He described Russell, that young man right there, as one of the best players in the country, bar none.
Ooh.
Oh! fumble. Ball on the ground. Georgia Southern picks it up. And they're still going. Big turnover. Breitenstein coughs it up. The Eagles pick it up, return it to Rico Agnew.
First team nose tackle. His penetration disrupts a mesh point between Mitch Allen and Eric Breitenstein. Wow, huge turnover, first one of the game.
And there you see Agnew last week, 2.5 sacks in that win against William and Mary. Really the first extended playing time a week ago. And that's, did you see his height? 6'4", 215, moves real, really good. And the coaches love his future. Uh-oh, miscommunication there. That'll go five back the opposite way for Georgia Southern.
False start. Offense, number 71, 5-yard penalty. First down.
Left tackle Dorian Bird, true freshman, starting at left tackle. The tackles on this offensive line, Dave, really stand out.
Yeah, they certainly do, and they've got a big job in their hands in terms of protecting Jabo Shaw. He's a guy that makes that offense run. He's going to be a coach and a teacher. Coach Paul Johnson supported his transfer from Georgia Tech to Georgia Southern and has paid big dividends for the Eagles.
First and 15. Right at the gut, going nowhere as we look at the impact players, Dave.
He gets the carry early on. There's J.J. Wilcox. He's a big play slot receiver. He's the guy they want to get the ball to in space. He can make it happen from anywhere on the field. And then there's the defensive lineman, the all-national guy. He can get it done. He leads the nation in sacks. He has 20 in his career, 12.5 on the season.
Amit Paul, the Canadian, has come on strong here at Wofford. And again, right up the middle, breaking tackles. Getting close to the first down is Robert Brown. Young man from Macon, Georgia, Tommy Irvin tripped him up. The all-conference defensive back.
Watch Brown just get the football in the midline option. Look at the offensive line, get to the second level. There he is, just enough for him to squirt through that hole.
Third down and one after that 13-yard pickup for Robert Brown. Nothing fancy for Georgia Southern up to this point, just right up the gut. Shaw keeps it. This is a pulling it out of the gut of the fullback. He's really smooth back there.
Well, it all starts with the quarterback again, making the right read. This time he just falls his fullback right up the middle. That's Robert Brown. The defenders go to tackle him. Jabo Shaw is free for the first down.
Offensive line for the Eagles, not big. Especially when you look at left tackle Dorian Bird, only 245, and right tackle Brett Moore, only 255. They have big spaces there along the offensive front, but they are quick, and they chop you low. There's the pitch. Nice gain on the outside. Lee Banks, his first carry. Amit Paul, his first tackle of the day.
Here's Brian Wilcher again. You talked about cut blocks. Watch outside if you get a chance. These guys, the offensive linemen, a four-point stance. The weight is forward. The wide receivers are going after the cornerbacks' blocks and legs. Watch this right here. Watch this offensive line come down. A little counter motion. The quick pitch outside. Look at that cut block right there. Defensive backs hate it. It gets on their minds. And that's what these wide receivers do a great job of for Georgia Southern.
Second and four.
Number five.
Back to the fullback again. That's Rob.
Southern too. You think about Paul Johnson, his coaching tree, and all the guys that have kind of followed his suit, what he's been able to do at Georgia Tech in the ACC.
Third down, a long one.
And really an area, last time in October, they were 3 of 13 on third down. They got improved.
Shaw again, just like he did the last time. Rolls forward down to the 35. Tommy Irvin tripped him up.
Again, watch the offensive line come off the ball. Again, he rides his fullback up inside. The fullback, instead of being a ball carrier, is now a lead blocker for...
They've done all their damage inside the tackles on this opening drive. Again, that's Robert Brown. And this offense, Dave, this is what has the Georgia Southern faithful excited. Jeff Monken got the job, and he said, I'm going to bring back the same offense we ran under Paul Johnson and Eric Russell. And everybody cheered in Statesboro, Georgia.
That's right, because it harkens back to the six national championships. It's really what's made this Georgia Southern program one of the top programs in FCS. And there he is right there, Coach Monken. Talked to him yesterday on the field. He said, boy, I go, how was the week? He goes, well, we didn't have a very good week of practice. He goes, I don't know what to think about it. We just hope we come out and play well early on in this ballgame.
He was very honest in telling us that. That's going to be another first down. That's J.J. Wilcox, his first carry. Again, Wilcox is a guy who lines up in the slot or in the backfield. And he might be calling the signals, Dave.
Yeah, and he can do it all, J.J. Cox. He can throw it. He can run it. He's a receiver. He's a guy that they use to make explosive plays offensively.
No passes yet for J.Bo Shaw in this offensive unit for Georgia Southern. Again, looking to the sidelines, and he looks on that wristband. Two players giving signals on the sideline. One is the dummy signal. The other is the legit call. His first pass. Wide open. Touchdown, Georgia Southern. Wide open, Trey Butler.
Eagle touchdown.
This is what Georgia Southern does to you. They lull you to sleep, they pound the rock, and they don't throw very often. When they do, they mean it. It's a wide open receiver right outside, Trey Butler. Watch the safeties come up right here, and then look how wide open Butler is for the touchdown.
Adrian Mora on for the extra point. He's been perfect this season. Right down the middle. Impressive march after the turnover. Nine plays, 69 yards. A large crowd up from Statesboro. They're loving it. Georgia Southern, impressive drive following that fumble, and they lead 7-0.
Watch what happens here. This is what they do. They're pounding the rock up inside. They're going to threaten the boundary side. You're going to see the safety come up here, the corner come up, and you're going to see Butler release right up the sideline. That's what the triple option does to you. You think run, you support run, and boom, here comes Georgia Southern with a big play down the field.
They suck you in, don't they? I mean, they just keep hammering that middle, and you saw Tommy Irvin and some of those safety men just sneak up ever so slightly, and boom, you get beat.
Well, they ask you to be involved in the running game. You're assigned a responsibility. It's 11-on-11 football, assignment orientation. You have to be able to decipher, read the hats of the guards, determine whether it's play action pass or run.
Billy Greer bounces one to Mike Rucker. Some blocks. It's up to the 22-yard line. And that's where the Terriers will begin their second drive of the day, trailing 7-0 here at Spartanburg. Welcome back to Spartanburg. Georgia Southern on top 7-0. Doug Bell alongside David Diaz Infante, the longtime Denver Bronco who was showing off that Super Bowl ring yesterday to the Wofford Terriers. Hey, those guys were impressed, Dave.
Well, they are, and they should be. They've got a chance to win their own national championship game.
Let's check on the scores now elsewhere. Week, Villanova stunning top seed, number one ranked Appalachian State, 28-17. Still lots of time in that one.
Yeah, I know. Appalachian State and that offense can explode at any moment.
Terrier's second drive. Again, Allen from that shotgun look. Multiple formations.
He loses the football. Another turnover. Georgia Southern rambles into the end zone. John Douglas. Eagles are soaring here in Spartanburg.
All right, you're going to see him again out of that pistol formation. They're going to run option into the wide side of the field. Look at the play and hesitation that the Georgia Southern makes. Again, fumble by Mitch Allen at the quarterback position. You see him riding down, and there he is, number 18. Lavelle Westbrook's coming in right away, blitzing from that corner, reading run, and again, disrupts that ball, and second fumble on the day.
Adrian Mora boots it through. And the Terriers are stunned here at home. Two turnovers. This one leads to an instant score. Touchdown, John Douglas. Georgia Southern has shocked Wofford here in the first quarter, jumping out to a 14-0 lead, Dave. Unbelievable.
Well, and defensive coordinator Brent Pry talked about they had to create turnovers. Watch what they do here. You're going to see this safety cheat up. That means he's coming. The slot defender is going to blitz to pressure that option. Again, great call by the defensive coordinator. He's there to surprise Mitch Allen. He causes the turnover. It's pressure defensively, and it's one of the big keys for them as a defensive unit. They've got to find a way to create turnovers. Job well done so far.
Here you see John Douglas. Played at Auburn a year ago. Was a fullback at Auburn. Wanted to come somewhere where he'd had more playing time, and his dad played for the legendary Irk Russell here at Georgia Southern back in 1981. Had a connection, and you know he's all smiles right now. What a big play.
He's living up to his end of the deal right now. What a way to get the fumble, pick it up for six.
Well, the Georgia Southern sideline. And get it going on their opening drive. They moved the ball, Dave, despite a couple of penalties. They were certainly in position, and then the big turnover has resulted in two scores for Georgia Southern.
Yeah, and you got to give credit to Georgia Southern, the Eagles, defensively. It's penetration by Brent Russell that causes the first fumble, and then it's a well-timed blitz by the Eagles defensive coordinator Brent Pry to cause that last one.
And another mistake for Wofford, a block in the back. And so the ball will be moved back now just inside the 11-yard line. So Mitch Allen will try to get this offense back on track. Eric Breitenstein lined up right behind him, number 7. Breitenstein gets wrapped up. Miscommunication. Here is Eubanks on the stop for the Eagles. Breitenstein kind of hiccuped a little bit before he took off there.
I think he got away with one there, that's for sure, towards the line of scrimmage. It'd be interesting to see. And this is where Mitch Allen, you know, they talk about his leadership skills. He needs to calm the ship right now. They need to find
Stein again, right behind Trey Johnson and Pat Illig.
In terms of rushing the football, Georgia Southern, they're third, huh?
First quarter going by quickly. Allen has an open receiver, Devin Reed, and just threw it past him by about 3 yards. So it'll bring up the first. He was an outstanding baseball player here at Wofford. Right fielder, added 333 a year ago. He will boot it away. Darion Robinson standing back at the 42. And he takes off. Breaking free. Tripped up down to the 33-yard line. And the Eagles are in business again.
Albafino will be carrier.
Relatively short kick.
But I like what Robinson did. Not a lot of nonsense back there. Took it north and south vertically, attacking that coverage team. Positive yards. Now look how this game has shifted. Clearly in favor of Georgia Southern early on.
Georgia Southern in Statesboro. The enrollment close to 20,000. Jeff Munkin, the head coach. They've won the FCS championship six times. They're very proud of their tradition, and Munkin has been a big part of that. Assistant for Paul Johnson when now the Georgia Tech coach won a couple of national titles in Statesboro. And timeout, Georgia Southern. Peter said one word.
Yeah, what did I say? And that's what you need out of that position more than any other one on the field. A guy that runs the offense, pulls the trigger for you. And when you really think about confidence of this football team, and we're seeing that play itself out right here early on in this ball game.
As we broke down tape and we watched a lot of action, from the beginning of the year till now, it's an entirely different football team on both sides. I mean, they are so much more adept moving the football, and defensively, they're wrapping up and stopping people. They didn't do that early on this season. And here they come after the timeout.
Coach Munkin there making sure his guys are ready to roll and take advantage of this possession. Again, a chance to really step on the throats of Wofford early on in the first half of this ballgame.
Shaw giving it to the up back again. Robert Brown on the carry. And you saw he pulled back at the very last second. I mean, the quarterback has to read that handoff, Dave. It's really fun to watch. And he waited the last possible second.
He did. It looks like both guys wanted it. A little confusion there. Robert Brown said, hey, I got it. And Shaw said, hey, I think I want to keep it now. Good thing that ball didn't end up on the ground, though.
It's Darion Robinson who returned that last punt so effectively, gets it close to a first down. Up at the top of our broadcast. Another first down there, 3 for 3. Robert Brown, a pep in his step. McCrimmon on the stop for Wofford.
Number 57, McCrimmon.
And watch the offensive line for Georgia Southern, too. Caving down that line of scrimmage, and it's breaking a tackle right there by Robert Brown as a linebacker scraped late for Wofford.
Brown is a freshman out of Macon, Georgia. Very talented. As described by the coaching staff, had fumble-itis early on this season, has not been the problem during this five-game winning streak. That time he pulled it out of the gut of the fullback. Robinson takes the pitch and gets run out of bounds. The defense very well by the Terriers. Blake Wiley led that charge. Here's the number three.
And again, the key is make that option, go towards the sidelines, and then you're going to see Tommy Irvin finish it up. Blake Wiley, again, early penetration. Look, gets them going. Look at the two corners and safeties coming up that Blake Wiley and Tommy Irvin, the leader of that second.
First quarter, we expected that. And Georgia Southern has come out on a serious roll. The Terriers, right now, no bite. Down 14-0. Getting ready for the start of the second quarter. The Terriers a bit stunned right now. Look, the eyes are kind of bright. They don't know what's going on. 14-0. Doug Bell alongside David Diaz Infante. And Dave, turnovers. We talked to all the coaches, and every one of them talked about turnovers. It's been the story.
Well, and specifically, defense coordinator Brent Pry talked about the need for his defense to create turnovers, and they did it right away off the bat in the first two possessions of Wofford. Again, as Brent Russell causing penetration at the best point, first turnover advantage to Georgia Southern. And they're able to convert that into a touchdown, the only pass of the game. Again, it's only one thing to create turnovers, another thing to make the other team pay for it. And there it is right there, a run blitz defensively that gets things going for Georgia Southern again.
First play of the second quarter, the pitch back to Robinson. And again, Georgia Southern has it going. Nothing fancy offensively for Georgia Southern. Everything we saw on tape, everything I think Wofford expected.
Yeah, we knew they weren't going to throw much. When they do, it's going to mean something for them. But really, it's been the inside run game, the midline option part of their offense that's really gotten it going. Got to give credit to the offensive line and Jabo Shaw.
Let's see what happens now for Georgia Southern as they look to go up by three touchdowns and build on this lead. A stunned home crowd here at Gibbs Stadium. Third down. Robert Brown gets hammered by Eberhardt. First time we've called Eric's name today, and that's going to be key when you have Eberhardt in the middle making some stops. That is important. There you see him on the ground. No, check that. That's Amit Paul, their All-America candidate, the player of the year in the Southern Conference on the defensive side.
And I tell you what, watching him on tape, he has some great first step quickness, unbelievable hands, ability to turn his shoulders and his hips, and that's why he's one of those dominant players in FCS.
Here he is, trying to shake it off. You know, he's listed at 6 feet, 245, and as we watched him yesterday, Dave, he's not 6 feet or 245, but the one thing that he does have, quickness.
He has quickness, and I tell you, I don't know how big he is, but he's big enough. When you have 12 and a half sacks, eight quarterback hurries, you're doing something right. And 20 tackles for a loss.
It'll be a 33-yard field goal try for Adrian Mora. And Mora kicks it right down Broadway, so it's 17-0 Georgia Southern. The Eagles are continuing to put the hammer down on the throw to Wofford. Terriers, we'll have it when we come back. It is a beautiful campus here in Spartanburg, South Carolina. I was totally blown away here at Wofford College. Enrollment only about 1,450. But the facilities here for the students and the student athletes are just off the charts. I mean, Dave, I was blown away yesterday. It really is a pretty place.
Yeah, first-class college it is in terms of facilities. Obviously, a small school feel, kind of almost like a little Ivy League feel out here. The campus, the grounds, it's very nice, very traditional.
When you see the football field, they have that rye grass mixed in because on the outside, you see that Bermuda has gone dormant, that yellow grass in the end zone, but the field is natural grass, and it is close to perfect. Here we are in December. I haven't seen a field look that good anywhere.
Well, you sound like a man that spent a little time on the golf course is what I'm thinking.
Absolutely. I want the tee box to look like that back home. Billy Greer has been busy. His fourth kickoff so far in this first half. And again, here comes Mike Rucker. Out past the 20. Nice coverage for Georgia Southern. Let's look at the brackets now of this FCS championship. So exciting. I was in Montana last year. Love covering this. Villanova stunning Appalachian State 35-24. And last night we watched Delaware outlast New Hampshire coming on late in the game. How surprised are you that App State losing at home?
It's It's unbelievable. You can't think about it too. They're an explosive offense. It's kind of, they've been dominating, really. You think about the skilled athletes they have there. They know how to score some points.
They've won it three times in a row. About to go down at home today. Breitenstein, another carry. Speaking of App State, Breitenstein's brother was a member of those three teams at App State that have gone back to back to back. So I'm sure he hears it from Big Bro. Hey, we've done it. How about you?
Yeah, and interesting, he decided not to go to Appalachian State. Instead, he came here. But, you know, he's the ideal guy for this offense.
Flag down on the play.
Pass complete to
that ball is complete
19,
to Devin Reed. Looks like that's going to come back. Again, Dave Epperly, our referee from the Big South.
Holding. Offense, number 53, 10-yard penalty, second down.
New quarterback in for Wofford is Brian Cass, a freshman from Raleigh, North Carolina. Again, we spent some time with Wade Lang yesterday, who showed his tape on Cass. He's the passer, I guess you might say, when you compare him to Mitch Allen.
Well, he could do things with the ball in his hand, running it as a guy running that option part of the offense, but certainly probably the more accurate thrower of the two.
So Cass gets an opportunity now, second down and 15. Himself. A terrific tackle by Darius Eubanks, a safety man a year ago, now is a hard-hitting linebacker for Georgia Southern.
Watch Brian Cass again, that reverse option coming out the backside. What, look at that, look at his eyes, look at him make the read, quick decision, knows he's going to keep the football, gain positive yards.
A big third down and 8 for Brian Cass and these Terriers of Wofford. 1 for 3 today on third down conversions. There's the blitz. Loses the football, another turnover. And Georgia Southern says they have it, but I think the Terriers are on the bottom of that pile.
Looks like it's Roderick Tinsley. Look, it's all out blitz up the middle, and it's Tinsley again defeating the one-on-one block. Watch, he's going to get the strip. You see him turn his hips, shoulders, swat his big arm out there, and strip Cass of the football.
Big Brent Russell came out of the pile with a football for Georgia Southern, but the official said no, possession goes to Wofford. So they will punt it away, a win-win for the defense of Georgia Southern.
And you know, if there's a scramble for the football on the bottom of the pile, Brent Russell's coming out with it.
And then Bennett, boy, that went off the side of his foot. That was a shank. Does get a positive rollout. It'll be down at the 49, but in Georgia Southern territory. The 2010 NCAA Women's Volleyball Championship begins Thursday, December 16th at 7 Eastern, live on ESPN2, and it's also in HD. For more information on the NCAA Women's Volleyball Championship, go to NCAA.com, the official online home for all 88 NCAA championships. Glad you're with us today.
Car from Winter for a limited time only.
Shaw has a wide open receiver. First down, Georgia Southern. That's Tyler Sumner. His first catch today.
And I go, when your defense is up there playing run, look at the linebackers suck up to that play action. It leaves Sumner wide open right up the seam. Just a little pop pass over the middle off the play action. Again, the threat of running of the running game just allows your receivers to get open down the field.
That goes for 19 yards. Robert Brown lined up right behind Jaybo Shaw. Takes the handoff.
Number 5 carries.
Moves forward. And that's the base play of this triple option attack. Everything gets set up off that base play to the up back of the fullback.
It sure does. And this defense of Wofford, they have to step up. In their last meeting, when they won 33-31, they had 4 sacks, 12 tackles for a loss. They shut them out late in the fourth quarter. 3 and 2, 3 and outs. to end the football game. They got to find a way to step in, step up right here and right now.
Shaw with the pitch. First down, breaking free. Inside the 10-yard line is Wilshire, his second carry.
You're going to see Wilshire, too, the motion guy. Watch the blocking out here on the perimeter, too. Two wide receivers getting it done outside. J.J. Wilcox and Tyler Sumner, again, on the perimeter blocking. So key to this option offense. Everyone must buy into it. Great example of that unselfishness by Georgia Southern right there.
That was an 18-yard pickup as you look at the yardage numbers. Wofford has moved the football, but again, two turnovers have been absolutely huge here in the first half. Back to Robert Brown. Wofford trying to strip that ball. You see six black jerseys around him. Mike Nyhem was there along with Tommy Irvin.
I love to see the fight in Tommy Irvin right there. He's a guy that gets it done for them in the second half of the in the secondary for their defense. He's smart. He makes all the checks. And he's a guy that's really worked on improving his game. And the pro scouts are taking the notice. He's got good size, great intelligence, and he can run.
Jabo Shaw, one last glance at that wristband with the plays. Keeps it himself. Runs right in the arms of Mike Nyhem. Nyhem is an interesting story, Dave, as you look at the replay. Here's a kid who blew out his knee, tore the ACL against Wisconsin a year ago, and this year tore the meniscus in the same knee, had to sit out the first five games. Boy, he has come on strong here late in the year.
And he's fought his way back, and he's 6'4", 245, playing that inside linebacker position. Great play in tandem by both linebackers. As one fills the dive, the other scrapes over the top, and that's Mike Nyhem.
Third and goal. And the pitch. Brown looking for the end zone. Flag comes flying in from the back judge.
I think they're called J.J. Wilcox for holding on the edge.
Holding. Offense. Number 19. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Third down.
Again, we talked about their unselfishness and blocking on the perimeter. You're going to see it, too, as he backs off. He gets a quick flip. There he is right there. He's got to let go of that jersey right there. You're on the edge. The officials are there to make the throw, and you see what a great toss by the official back there, too. Great position to make that call. Again, you've got to know when to let go of that jersey. You're on the edge and clear sight of everybody.
So, again, third and goal this time from the 12-yard line. Shaw off the fingertips of Mitchell Williford.
Look at this defense then stand up again, pressuring Jabo Shaw outside, forcing the high throw on the run. Look at this, Wofford defense has held two field goals right now. They're starting to gain some momentum. Again, not bending but not breaking.
Mora kicked his first field goal from 33, this from 28 yards. And he misses that one. Yanks that a little bit to the left, so that is a huge stop for Wofford. First the touchdown nullified by the penalty, and now the missed field goal. Snap good, hold good, kick, no good. ...17-0 after the missed field goal. Big stop for Wofford. Now, when you look at this series between these two schools, the last meeting back in October in Statesboro, total of 9 points to determine the last three wins between Wofford and Georgia Southern. And this game went back and forth. Eric Breitenstein scored both of his touchdowns in the fourth quarter. And the second one proved to be the eventual winner. With about 6 minutes to go in the game, Southern had the ball with a minute and got stopped on fourth down. And it was 33-31.
And look at that right there, too. That defense with those four sacks and 12 tackles for a loss. That's what they've got to pick up. So far, the defense starting to pick up some momentum. Let's see if any of that carries over to the offense right here.
Ike Ayers in his 23rd season as head coach of Wofford. First time in his 40-year coaching career he's ever played the same opponent twice in one season. And that was a mess from the get-go. Brian Cass again in there at quarterback.
False start. Offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
And that's Wofford's fifth penalty on the afternoon so far. The two turnovers, penalties. This is starting to become, you know, a self-inflicted wound here for the Terriers. They've got to find a way to right the ship, calm themselves down, and start really executing offensively.
Five penalties for 35 yards. Dave starting to mount up. First down and 15. Cass changes the play. Gets the signal from the sideline. Breitenstein right up the gut. Gets the first down as he rumbles forward. Big play for the junior. Eric Breitenstein. That goes for 20 yards.
And this is what he has the ability to do. Look at that offensive line getting to the second level. It's a quick hit and play right up the gut. Again, that pistol formation allows him to get some depth, clears up his vision, and he's really benefited from this formation this second half of the season.
Breitenstein has put up huge numbers in his career at Wofford. Again, a gaping hole as he goes forward for close to another first down. His jersey a bit on the dirty side, and that's just standard operating procedure for that big guy.
Yeah, that's what you're supposed to have right there. And you see the quick feet in the hole, which takes vision and then athletic ability. Look at Appalachian State. Wow. Three-time defending national champion trailing in the fourth quarter.
About to go down at home. Cass loses the football again. Still no signal. Georgia Southern emphatic, saying they have the football. Wofford actually came out of the pile. And it is Terriers football. Brian Cass had it at the bottom of that pile. So Cass comes to the sidelines, and Mitch Allen now comes back in at quarterback. Enjoyed talking to Mitch Allen yesterday as we spent time with Allen and Pat Illig and Breitenstein after practice, along with defensive star Tommy Irvin. Another fumble for the Terriers. Miscommunique between Mitch Allen and Donovan Johnson.
And this is unbelievable. This start for Wofford right here. Again, just a mesh point up inside. I can't tell whether he's trying to hand it off or is he trying to pull it. You can see him right there, just tips the edge of his running back, Donovan Johnson. Again, ball security priority number one for the quarterback when you're running this offense.
Third down. Allen stumbles. Gets his feet set. Has his man for a first down. That's Devin Reed. That's good for 13 yards and a first down.
Watch Mitch Allen again. Set his feet. Look at him wind up, deliver that ball. That's a fastball strike. And look at the route by Reed. Again, coming back to the football. Runs his route, the depth of the sticks, and enough yardage to pick up the first down. Excellent discipline, excellent route running by Reed.
So Mitch Allen will come to the sidelines. A bit dinged up after that last play. Brian Cass back in at quarterback now. Breitenstein hammers forward over the right side. Another first down for the Terriers.
Watch Breitenstein. Coaches talk about his quick feet in the hole, and he's been a little dinged up. Watch this jump cut he makes. You're going to see him scoot through the hole. Boom, right there, and that real speed. Watch him just shuffle his feet, extend the hole, cut to the right, and then pick up extra yardage.
Breinstein battling a shoulder bruise. Has been very uncomfortable, but has not kept him out of much action. Missed most of the second quarter last Saturday at Jacksonville State.
He told us he's fine. He'll be fine for today. I'd love to see that.
Donovan Johnson got pushed down and actually pushed forward. Darius Eubanks shoved him down, but in the process gained a couple of yards. So the Terriers are in business. After the missed field goal, they've taken the ball and moved it back down to the 30-yard line. If they can muster up enough energy and moxie to score here, we got ourselves a ball game, David.
That's right. Huge possession for the Terriers right now.
Rucker. Brightside now running back in. Missed the last couple of plays. It'll bring up third down for the Terriers. Again, the Terriers are one of two schools with a nickname, the Terriers.
2 for 5 right now on fourth down, on third down. That's not going to get it done here this afternoon.
Huge third down. Cass. Up the middle, huge game, Jeremy Marshall.
Jeremy Marshall.
And Brian Cass took a shot after that handoff. They unloaded on the quarterback.
Boy, you got to be a tough cat to run this offense. Watch this again, a quick trap up inside. Cass takes a hit, but look at number 5, Jeremy Marshall again. The quickness in the hole, running north and south. Boy, got to cover up that football when you're running through traffic. He's a senior out of Georgia.
20 yards and a first down, first and goal. Ball's on the 4-yard line. Breitenstein working his way for what he hopes is his 23rd touchdown this season on the ground. Tinsley wraps him up. It'll be second and goal, the ball in about the 1.5-yard line. They're inching closer for their first score of the day. This will ignite the home crowd, which is on the press box side. They have been very quiet. Georgia Southern's done most of the cheering today. Breitenstein lines up behind Brian Cass. He takes it and they hit him low. That's the perfect place to tackle. The hammer hit him low, tripped him up. Josh Gebhardt on the stop for the Eagles. Third and goal.
And that was Josh Rowe again blitzing through the line of scrimmage. Penetration was stops that play. Breitenstein had no chance to go anywhere with football. Rowe able to time his blitz up the A gap in the backfield with his legs, his arms around the legs of Breitenstein.
Lost 2. Third and goal from the 3. The pitch. Looking for the end zone. No. Jeremy Marshall gets chopped down. Well, LaRon Scott, fourth down.
I tell you what, this Georgia Southern defense, watch them all attacking the line of scrimmage. They're penetrating inside, force a quick pitch outside. Now look at the pursuit. Look at the running. Watch them fight off the block, LaRon Scott again. There it is. They got this thing going east and west. That's what you want to do defensively. Look at that. Fighting off the block, taking out the legs of the running back. That is great effort, great desire to make a play right there.
Christian Reed looks to get Wofford on the board. A 21-yard field goal attempt. Reed was that unusual number for a kicker, 73.
Timeout, Georgia Southern, their second. 30-second timeout.
And again, Georgia Southern calling the timeout. Perhaps they saw something that would lead them to a fake field goal. They wanted the timeout. Again, Wofford College here in Spartanburg. The enrollment just shy of 1,500. Longtime members of the Southern Conference, which goes way back. In fact, prior to the Southeastern Conference, it was the Southern Conference. When a shift was made, Mike Ayers is the head coach, and he was winner this year of the Wallace Wade Coach of the Year Award. famous alums from Wofford University, Jerry Richardson, who still holds the record for most receptions in a career.
Look at today.
The Panthers.
The Carolina Panthers hold their training camp here at Wofford. One of the big donors here at the school as well, upgraded these facilities. You can see why Coach Ayers has been here on his 23rd season. What a beautiful campus, what great facilities. Why would a coach want to go anywhere else?
So Georgia Southern gets it straight. They have their assignments down. They've seen something on tape. They are going to kick the field goal. It's good for Christian Reed, and Wofford is on the board. They get the stop, drive it down for a field goal. Two touchdown difference here in Spartanburg. Eric Breitenstein of Wofford retaping that ankle, David.
That's right. He's got that moleskin on the outside, taping it right to the skin, make sure it's extra tight. He's a guy, boy, they need to get him back in the game and rolling.
And Chris White is warming up on the sidelines. He's the third string quarterback for Wofford. Mitch Allen did come off a bit shaken up, and Brian Cass took a shot on that last drive. So we'll watch this very closely. White hasn't played a lot this season, but is certainly getting that arm loose on the sidelines.
And in this first half of play, boy, Wofford is getting beat up on the field, but also physically as well in terms of getting dinged a few players. Feeling so far in the first half.
Casey Redfern will kick off for Wofford, and LaRon Scott, who made that touchdown saving tackle, is deep for Georgia Southern. And the ball, as the wind kicks up a bit, the ball blows off the stand. Casey will get it set one more time. Young man from North Carolina. It's interesting, 23 players in the Wofford roster are from the state of Georgia. And for Georgia Southern, they do not have one player from South Carolina on their roster. His first kickoff goes out of bounds. That was not the result they were looking for.
No, sir. You got one job. That's to kick it between the lines. And now
illegal,
you get
kick
Georgia
out of
Southern.
On the kicking team, the ball will be spotted at the 40-yard line. First down.
Now Georgia Southern gets great field possession.
Just over a minute to play before halftime. Georgia Southern has been the benefactor of a couple of huge turnovers by Wofford. The Terriers have played a sloppy first half, lots of penalties. Jay Shaw has been flawless in running this triple option attack. They have one timeout remaining, and that'll be their last timeout. So the Eagles, with 105 remaining, have no timeouts left.
And Shaw taking that one right there. Some kind of miscommunication from the sidelines to their quarterback. Also really important defensively for Wofford right now to find a way to keep Georgia Southern out of the end zone, keep this a two-touchdown game going into the halftime. Be a huge momentum boost for them. Allow them to come back out in the second half and try to establish something.
Enjoyed talking to Coach Monken this week on our conference call, and yesterday during the walkthrough, David, pretty straight shooter. And he's the son of a coach. In fact, his three brothers are also into coaching. His dad has coached for almost four decades on the high school level up in Illinois. I mean, it's in his blood.
Well,
it's in his DNA.
Yeah, certainly is. Once in the blood, always in the blood, the game of football, that's for sure, especially on the coach's side. You think he spent 13 years with Paul Johnson, learned from one of the best, and no real surprise to his immediate success here at Georgia Southern.
So no timeouts. First and 10 from the 40. Shaw gets a first down. That'll stop the clock for the moment after the big game. Tommy Irvin on the stop for Wofford. Shaw hustling his team into position. All right, here comes the clock. There's a pickup of 14. Trying to answer the first score of the day for Wofford. Shaw better hurry. The heat was coming down. That ball was deflected and goes incomplete. So they'll stop the clock. Amit Paul Got his mitt up there. Haven't called his name much. And that's good news for Georgia Southern, not so good for Wofford, because Paul is their stud on defense.
Yeah, it sure is. And you look at what Georgia Southern's trying to do there from the far hash, sprinting that to the left, trying to shorten that distance to the throw for Shaw, working the sidelines, trying to conserve some time off the clock.
J.J. Wilcox in the slot for Georgia Southern. And Trey Butler, the lower portion of your screen, wide right. Fires it to the outside. Butler goes down and grabs it, and that'll stop the clock. Another first down. They're getting in field goal range,
yeah,
Dave.
Yeah, they certainly are.
Here's a good look at Trey Butler.
Watch Butler again run this route, stop on a dime, turn back to the quarterback, present the target, make the catch for the first down.
Shaw rolls to his left. And getting out of bounds is Tyler Sumner. He's inside the 25-yard line, or right at it is where the spot will be.
And like we said, you know, Georgia Southern is not really in a throwing football team. But when they do, they're pretty darn efficient with it.
Well, a couple of Georgia Tech games a year ago when J-Bo Shaw got in the game, Paul Johnson had no problem at all putting this kid in the game. He said he knows the offense.
I probably wish they had him back of this year, as injuries kind of took the wind out of the sails of Georgia Tech second half of the season.
Shaw, the son of a coach, wants to be a coach himself. Looking, that goes incomplete. Bring up third down. Right now they're in the range of Adrian Mora, right at the range. He missed his last field goal attempt. It would be a 42-yard field goal from where he would kick it right now. And as long as it's been 45, Dave, we watched him before the game. And he really is an accurate kicker, even though he missed that last one. I wouldn't say he has an exceptionally strong leg.
No, but strong enough, certainly with the long of 45. And it'd be interesting to see what Georgia Southern decides to do with the football right here.
Third down. They need three for a first down. Shaw keeps it himself. Huge game. Shaw breaks free. Inside the 5-yard line. 7 seconds. They need to hurry to kill this ball. They'll spike it. The clock is now ticking down. There's the spike with 4 seconds. 21-yard pickup for J-Bo Shaw. And Adrian Mora will run onto the field to kick it.
Yeah, great call by Brent Davis, offensive coordinator. Quarterback lead draw. Look at the blocking up front. J-Bo Shaw heads to the side. He looks like he thought he was going to score for a second. And you look at the situational football right now by Georgia Southern to manage this possession and get a chance in field goal.
21 yards from the right hash mark, and that one's good. He missed the previous kick from 22 from the left hash mark. And that angle is perfect for the right-footed kicker. So Georgia Southern in control as you look at the rushing numbers. Not as lopsided as you would think, David. The turnovers were the big story.
Yeah, they certainly were. Two turnovers in the first two possessions by the Terriers. And again, it was Georgia Southern's ability to translate those turnovers into points.
So once again, Wofford fell into a hole early on. Down 17-0, but fought their way back. But Georgia Southern, without any timeouts, drives down to take that halftime lead. There's the final. Villanova has upset the three-time defending national champion Appalachian State, and Villanova advances to the semifinals. Let's go down now to Mike Ayers. Coach, your comments on the first half. Tough start. The turnovers put you in a hole.
No doubt. We're our own worst enemy. Balls on the ground way too much. Just not executing. Georgia Southern's doing a great job with their offense. We're not being productive with the football on offense. We've had way too many turnovers. They've outplayed us. They've basically kicked our tail in this first half. But the great thing is there's two halves of football. We're going to see if we can change it.
All right. Hey, Coach, when you look at your quarterback position, how do you manage that going in the second half? Looks like you got some guys banged up.
We do. I'll go in, check it, see how we are, and then we'll go with what we got.
All right, Coach. Good luck in the second
half.
That's Mike Ayers. Told it like it was. Said Georgia Southern just kicked our butt in the first half. Great tackling, taking advantage of miscues, and Georgia Southern on top of the half. We're starting the third quarter here in Spartanburg, South Carolina. The Eagles of Georgia Southern on top 20-3. And Dave, early on, as we look at the highlights, turnovers played a big factor.
Yeah, they certainly did. And that's Brent Russell again from his nose guard position causing that fumble. And then they were allowed Georgia Southern to turn that into points on the other end offensively. Then it came to throwing the football. They don't throw it much. When they do, it usually means something. They're able to catch Wofford's defense being a little too aggressive. And then it's aggressiveness and great blitz run call by Georgia Southern to cause that fumble. And again, it's Douglas returning it for 6 points.
And again, Wofford had trouble with their quarterbacks. Watch this. After the pass, Mitch Allen got hit at the tail end of that play, and then Brian Cass gets blown up.
Yeah, he sure did. Both the quarterbacks getting beat up a little bit in that first half, and that's how aggressive that Georgia Southern defense has been in the whole first half of play here. It's been playing in the backfield of Wofford, and that's something the offensive line has got to take ownership of for Wofford and try to change the trend that was certainly the first half of play.
We're told by the Sports Information Department that both quarterbacks were questionable to start the second half, but we will say Mitch Allen, who you see there, and Brian Cass were warming up on the field just moments ago. Still no official word whether they will start the second half or not. Georgia Southern gets the ball to start. Hit it at the 20 and brought out past the 40-yard line. Another short kick. And a nice return by Kyle Delbeck. He was the up man. And I think he was as surprised as anybody that the ball was short and came to him.
Well, now again, to start the second half play, Georgia Southern has great field position. We'll see if they capitalize on it.
And Georgia Southern with that 20-3 lead will be very patient. You're going to see that play a lot to Robert Brown.
We certainly will. That ball is going to run up the gut of that defense. See if they can do anything to stop it. See Jabo Shaw right there again. 5 rushes, 50 yards, 4 of 8 throwing through the ball through the air. Just enough to be dangerous right there. Great balance offensively for them because they're a run-first football team. When they throw the ball, it's usually for big plays down the field.
Second down and 6. Shaw gets nailed, brought down, actually lost yardage on that play.
Number 14 on the carry, Jabo Shaw.
Very nice tackle there by Keaton Thompson. One of those Georgia kids on the Wofford roster.
You see Thompson there, the 230-pound senior again. Now they're taking a page from Georgia Southern. Watch him attack the line of scrimmage and then attack the quarterback. Outside in, again, playing his responsibility as Georgia Southern tries to run into the boundary of the field.
3rd and 7. Eagles are 4 out of 6 so far. Third down conversions on the day. Shaw ran out of time and gets thrown down. Eric Eberhardt now has 5.5 sacks on the season.
There he is, a big man running off the field, chasing down Jabo Shaw. Again, the back half of Wofford's defense, again, nowhere for them to throw the football. They played it correctly, played disciplined, played smart.
Charlie Edwards, the punter for Georgia Southern. Jeff Munkin described him as his best offensive player this season. The best punter in the conference, one of the best in the country. And that bounded into the end zone. Boy, that was a heck of a kick. If not for that unlucky bounce, it would have been right inside the 5-yard line. Mitch Allen was shaken up in that second quarter, but now back to start the third quarter. Cleared by the medical staff, and again, they take no chances. And he would not be out there unless the medical staff deemed him A-OK. So he'll start the third quarter, which is good news. And there's a quick penalty.
Offsides. Defense, number 66. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Big Brent Russell trying to jump the gun just by a fraction of a second, got caught.
That's right, and you're right, lined up right over the football. You got to watch it again. That just goes to show you what this Georgia Southern defense has been doing, attacking the line of scrimmage, trying to play in the backfield of Wofford.
So first down and five, Breitenstein lines up behind his quarterback, dodges that first tackler. In fact, John Stevenson was there, and he dodged him and gets very close to a first down. And it is a first down, Dave.
Yeah, you got to think John Stevenson was sitting there going, what just happened there? I thought I was in the hole. And then you see Breitenstein, his ability, that quick kind of jump cut. It's very subtle, very effective.
Breitenstein again over the left side. And again, just broke a couple of on tackles. As we watch tape, it is amazing how many tackles this kid breaks.
Yeah, he's an old school type player. You're going to see, watch when he handles the football too. Not only does he have, look at the spin move, does he drive his legs, but look, he's always protecting the football. Ball security, paramount in his mind.
Breitenstein, 67 yards now and 12 carries, second down and five. Mitch Allen dives for the first down. Let's check the scoreboard now. The FCS championship. Next week, the semifinals, and they'll take a few weeks off before they play their championship. Eastern Washington on top of North Dakota State.
Yeah, Eastern Washington on that red turf. Boy, it's proven to be an advantage. I think they're 8-0 on it so far this year. Red unis, red turf.
It is a sight.
Unprecedented.
It's a sight to behold, Dave. It really is.
I love it.
Two straight first downs now for the Terriers. Robert Tinsley messed up that play. Allen pulled it out of the gut of Breitenstein and then got wrapped up.
And that's got to be a time when Allen makes a right read and gives it to Breitenstein right there, with Tinsley penetrating again, blocking the alley and running lane of Allen.
Mitch Allen, a 3.9 GPA in physics.
Holy smokes.
And we talked to him yesterday, and yeah, I was a little uncomfortable. Pretty bright kid. Breitenstein, again, just moving the pile. John Douglas on the stop for Georgia Southern, but not before another 5-yard pickup. Now it's third down for the Terriers. Third down and four. Crowd getting involved.
3 of 7 in the first half of play on third down for Wofford. We'll see if they can convert here.
Nothing fancy, and that's going to be short. Brent Russell got his nose in there, and there you see big number 94, Roderick Tinsley. I like Brent Russell. Boy, that number on the side of his helmet on the right side, it's already scraped off. All sorts of marks in that headgear.
Yeah, and he's the leader of that defense. He's the tough guy in the middle that really sets the tone for them defensively.
They're going for it, David. What do you think? Too early to be doing this?
Well, I like it. You got to make something happen. You're behind. It's the second half.
First down on target to Brent Burson. So the Terriers keep this drive going, their first drive in the third quarter.
Again, nice, simple pass play, a chance for Allen to play pitch and catch, a little play action, turn, quick, take care, and take advantage of the soft coverage played by Georgia Southern.
As we broke down tape, I mean, odds are Burson was going to get the look.
That's right.
He's their possession guy, 6'4 target. And you're right, that coverage was just too soft. First and 10. In Eagles territory. Picks up nine more.
Number 24 on the stop, Carson Hill.
Watch the offensive line just move down the field. that left side. Look at the big pulling guard. Illig right there leading the way. I'd love to see that. Clark Bishop and Breitenstein knows exactly what to do.
Rucker looking for some wiggle room, and Terrico Agnew said no way.
Third down.
They're so into hitting, they're hitting each other.
Another third down situation now for the Terriers, trying to keep it rolling. They're moving downhill. Very close to the marker. That's Donovan Johnson.
Number 99, Agnew on the side.
Again, working behind Big Pat Illig, 6'5", 320 pounds at left guard. Senior from Pittsburgh. NFL scouts have been monitoring his progress all season long. The Jacobs Award winner. Fourth down. And about a yard and a half. Breitenstein. Well, it's close.
Breitenstein on the carry.
I think they're going to give him the first down spot.
Boy, you talk about tough sledding right here. Look at the hard running, hard defense played by Georgia Southern. But I think it's the toughness of Breitenstein that gets this done. Look at the blockers come down. Look at Tinsley. It's not Tinsley. It's number 96, Blake Riley, defeating the block, getting in on the tackle.
They're going to measure, Dave. This is close. Comes the chain gang.
Boy, that's about as close as I've seen right there. Looked like by the spot and the official, looks like they had it picked up, but certainly this is closer than we anticipated.
Ooh, this is going to be close. Did he get it? Yes! By about an inch!
When they talk about this game being a game of inches, there's a great example of it right there. Blake Riley makes a great play in defending the block, defeating the block of the offensive line and then making the tackle, but it was all heart and effort by Breitenstein to pick up and convert that fourth down.
We saw defensive coordinator Brent Pry. Looking deep, has a man wide open. Touchdown, Wofford! Britton Burston! 37 yards, and Wofford is right back in it.
This is exactly what the doctor ordered for Wofford. Look at that little play action pitch, quick pitch outside. They got Burson down the sideline, wide open. He lays it up in the air, puts enough air that he can run underneath it. Touchdown, Wofford.
Christian Reed on for the extra point. And it's good. So Wofford has cut into that lead. Hey, look at that, wide open. Burson and the Terriers, they got their bite back. Wofford back in this one. There's the young man who caught the touchdown, Brenton Burson. And this is how he did it, David.
Yeah, watch right here. Look at Hayden right here at the safety position. He's going to bite up inside with the play fake. This corner's got outside leverage, and then watch Burson get inside. There it is, one-on-one, no inside safety help. Touchdown, Wofford. What a way to start the second half for Wofford. Their defense comes up with a good stand, and then offensively they take advantage of it, convert on two fourth downs, and go 12 plays, 80 yards for a touchdown.
Burson, his ninth touchdown grab of the season. Here you see Mitch Allen with the headsets on, feeling much better now than he did midway through that second quarter.
Got ourselves a ball game right now.
Yep. Casey Redfern with the kick. Again, a short kick, and Georgia Southern again with excellent field position up around the 41-yard line. If you look at the first four drives, no touchdowns, and that last drive they marched down the field 80 yards. with a long touchdown pass.
When you look back to the last possession of the first half, where Wofford's able to go 13 plays, 77 yards, have to settle for a field goal, but that that 3 points was critical. And more importantly, they found some rhythm offensively. They're able to carry that momentum into the second half.
Robert Brown and J.J. Wilcox in the backfield. This is Brown. And you think the Wofford defense and Eric Eberhardt are fired up?
Hey, football is a game of momentum, and right now it has shifted to the advantage of Wofford. They're at home. They know it's one and done. They've got to rally. It starts with the defense, and Eberhardt gets it started for them on this possession.
There's a Mitt Paul, that front three for Wofford. They're jumping around right now. Ball's getting fired up. Jay Boshaw. Very calm, cool, and collected, getting the right play. Keeping it himself. Points about 3 yards. As we look at the keys now, again for Georgia Southern, you talked about it at the beginning of the game, Dave. Let's revisit those.
Yeah, it's exactly playing out to their advantage. 4-7 on third down. That is outstanding championship football. Defensive discipline. They have forced 2 turnovers and translated that into 14 points.
Now the crowd from the Wofford sideline here at Gibbs Stadium, they're on their feet making the most noise they've made all afternoon. And now they're really revved up. Big stop, Alex Goltry.
And this is what they do out of this 3-4 defense. They slant, pinch, and move it. You're going to see him come down inside, and that's going to cause a penetration. He's going to make the play. Watch him bend back out and make the play on Jabo Shaw. Unbelievable. Great job by this defense stepping up when they had to.
Charlie Edwards, his second straight punt. Did not kick in the first half. And there's the fair catch call by Brenton Burson, a 36-yard punt. He's not happy with that. Wofford on the comeback trail. Doing it the old-fashioned way. They're earning it.
Our Carolina, our home, our house.
Welcome back to the FCS Championship quarterfinal. Georgia Southern and Wofford in the end zone here at Gibbs Stadium. The kids have an absolute blast sliding down on the cardboard. They could care less what the scoreboard says, Dave. They're having fun.
And the parents have a built-in babysitter right there in the end zone.
Absolutely. It looks like an older kid.
Yeah. There's some adults
sliding
down.
Some of the grown-ups are sliding down. Right now, Wofford sliding down the field against this Georgia Southern defense. Mitch Allen keeps it. Stevenson on the tackle for Georgia Southern. We see John from Stone Mountain, Georgia.
Just a sophomore playing that Will linebacker. Really kind of built like a safety. He's a guy that's very active, plays with speed.
Second down, and the crowd has certainly got back into it now for Wofford. They were quiet most of that first half. Breitenstein, he gets bottled up again. Tirico Agnew came on strong last week in their win against William and Mary. He has been very active today, Agnew.
His big number 66 right now is like Georgia Southern's defense on these first two downs, trying to stiffen things up, going, hey, we got to get back to what got us this lead in this football game, and that's aggressive, hard-nosed football.
Third down, a big third down. Here comes the blitz. Did he jump the gun? Yes. Flags are down. The sack by Josh Rowe, but he was offsides. Tried to time it, and I do believe he jumped the gun.
Offsides. Defense, number 10. 5-yard penalty, third down.
Again, a game of inches. Now that is the fourth penalty of the football game by Georgia Southern. They were attacking the line of scrimmage, timing the blitz as well in the first half. This time, just a second too early by Josh Rowe. And now, Wofford has a third and short, a much easier chance of converting right here. Extending the drive.
Mitch Allen under center. Third down, Breitenstein. He knew he was going to get it. He stretched forward. He'll be short. John Stevenson with a very nice tackle.
Watch Stevenson. We talked about him all broadcast. He's the guy that gets things done in the middle. Look at the big nose guard. A little club the center, take on the trapping guard. That's disruptive nose guard play by Russell right there, allowing his linebacker to come up and make the play.
Mike Ayers is going to go for it now on fourth down, deep in his own territory. We're still in the third quarter. Allen flushed out, has a man wide open. First down, Wofford. That's Jeremy Marshall. Oh, what a call. What a play by Mitch Allen.
Watch Mitch Allen avoid the pressure and then complete the throw down the field by Jeremy Marshall. Georgia Southern bringing the heat again, and Mitch Allen makes him pay for it.
Well, something tells me we're not going to see Landon Bennett, the punter, for the rest of the day.
Here's the pressure, and look who picks up the blitz. It's Breitenstein again that gives him the time to throw, to slide and hitch in the pocket.
That's Rucker.
Rucker on the carry.
Got
20.
Hit immediately by Roderick Tinsley.
Number 94, Tinsley makes the stop for the Eagles.
Tinsley has been real active.
Yeah, he is. He is having one heck of a ball game right there. He's kind of a long arm guy. That listen to 6'3". He looks like a tall 6'3" to me, though. Long arm, long leg. He eats up ground, and he's been a presence here this afternoon.
Second down. Wofford with 135 yards on the ground. Remember, they averaged 307 to lead the nation. Allen hurls it out there for a first down. Who else but Brent Burson? He's the go-to guy when they throw it. Allen just heaved that pass out there.
You want to talk about being a leader and taking on the heat, looking down the gun barrel. Watch Allen come back. Set. He knows he's going to take the hit because look who's coming. It's Big Russell closing down on him, and he throws a strike under duress.
Allen looking to the sidelines. Looking for that signal. Twice Mike Ayers in this third quarter has gambled on fourth down. It's now third down, about a yard and a half. Breitenstein gets the first down. That moves the chains.
Number 94, Tinsley on the stop. Terrier first down.
An offensive line again. Trey Johnson and Pat Illig at left guard. Johnson is the center. I mean, they jumped off the screen as we watched tape. Those guys are tough.
Well, we talked about who has to lead this charge for Wofford offensively. It's that offensive line to shut down that D-line of Georgia Southern.
Allen back with plenty of time. Throws it deep. In and out of the hands of Devin Reed. Allen laid it right in there, but good defense. Derek Hayden for the Eagles broke it up.
Watch the blitz pick up by Wofford right here. It's all out blitz. Look at the running backs. The offensive line gives him time to throw. Look at the throw he makes again, putting air on the football. Devin Reed had a chance to haul it in as Derek Hayden coming over from the safety position to break that up.
Boy, he really winds up, doesn't he, Mitch Allen?
Wow.
Breitenstein just hammers forward.
I tell you what, I like the aggressive play calling on first down. They go the play action. They know blitz is coming. The run blitz that Georgia Southern's been throwing at them all afternoon long. They take a shot down the field. Then they come back to their bread and butter, and that's Breitenstein right up the middle.
4 for 11 on third downs, but you know they're going for it on fourth down if they don't make it. That's just a given where they are right now. With a pitch, Rucker looking for the first down. He has it. He's out of bounds. Mike Rucker showing some speed, that burst.
He is showing a burst. He is showing patience. And watch how he follows his blockers right there. And look at the seam. He cuts up. That's the difference between converting the first down and not.
Big Clark Bishop, right tackle, number 53, all conference, led the charge. New set of downs from the 24. Allen keeps it himself. Loose football. Wofford got it back.
Number 20, Rucker recovers.
Mike Rucker jumped on that loose football. Mitch Allen has been a little careless today with it.
Oh, my. Right place, right time by Rucker. And Allen has to be less cavalier of that football. Tuck that thing up in traffic. Ball security has to be your number one priority at that position in this offense. It cost him dearly in the first half and almost cost him here in the second half.
That's the end of the third quarter, and what a quarter it was. The excitement level is at a fever pitch in Spartanburg. One more quarter to go. One quarter to go, and Wofford is working their way back into this one, down by 10. Another score, and who knows, Doug Bell, David Diaz, Infante. Mike Ayers went for it on fourth down twice, deep in his own territory. The old coach is showing me some moxie out there.
Yeah, he's showing his mettle for sure. And think about what their defense did to start the second half. 2-3 and outs defensively for Wofford. Then the offense is able to capitalize on it. And it's Allen to Dresden, again, the wide receiver, for a big play.
Second down and six. First play of the fourth quarter, down by 10. Allen gets hit just as he throws. And that'll bring up fourth down. And something tells me the coach may go for it again, although he's in field goal range.
Yeah, certainly, but he showed that he's willing to go for it. He's riding the momentum of his team right now in this second half. He talked about it before he went in for halftime. Said, hey, we've got to turn things around. It starts with our defense. And certainly, Allen's risen to the challenge. Made some big-time throws early in the second half.
Well, let's see. They're going to go for it now. It's actually third down, excuse me. So let's see what he does on third down. Allen from the gun. The pitch to Breitenstein. Knocked out of bounds. Exactly where the spot is. And David, they're going to go for it again.
Yeah, you know, I there's no doubt in my mind. They have some confidence right now going offensively. Looks like Breitenstein maybe had a chance to kind of dive for that first down. Wasn't quite sure where the marker was. But again, good, tough, hard running. Oh, and they gave him the first down.
He got the first down.
He did know where the sticks were. There you go, number seven. That's my man.
I thought he was going to be short, but that is the first down. So a new set of downs. They can forward. There you see big Brent Russell on the bottom of the pile for the Eagles.
Hey, there is some fighting going on in the middle of that offensive and defensive lines for both squads. Look at Russell. He's trying to do a little extra grinding on the bottom of the pile there. I kind of like it, but I tell you what, if you're an offensive lineman, you got to make sure you get a hat on him. You do some of your grinding yourself.
Breitenstein now has 100 yards on 21 carries. Current drive, 15 plays. This is number 16 on second down. Here's Rucker. He'll throw a pass into the end zone. Oh, off the fingertips. Brenton Burson.
Pitch pass. Rucker has him, just not quite enough air on the ball. Oh, you got to drop that win one on him. Oh, so close and yet so far. Big third down here coming for Wofford.
Everybody on their feet at Gibbs Stadium. Whether you're rooting for the Eagles or the Terriers. Yeah. led by Brent Russell. There he is, 66. Boy, what a game he is. Look at him. He's wolfing it. The Terriers.
Oh, yeah. He's doing some grunting. He's doing a little talking. And what he's doing is dominating the inside of that defensive line and offensive line right there in the middle. He's holding his ground.
Christian Reed, 27-yard field goal attempt. Has one already today. This will pull him within a touchdown. And he does. He drills it. Number 73, that's old school. Good snap, perfect hold. Right down the middle. Wofford making it interesting here on their home field, trailing the Eagles by 7. You talk about tradition. No one boasts 6 national championships. The first came, 1985. The biggest comeback in FCS history against Furman. A year later, Irk Russell's team goes back to back. And the Eagles had their program on a serious roll in 89. They do it again, Ernest Thompson over the top. Then came the demolition of Nevada in 1990. And then Paul Johnson takes over. And check out Adrian Peterson. Walter Payton Award winner. And if you ever saw him play in person, he was incredible. And then the last came in 2000 on a muddy field. They outlasted Montana, the Grizz, 27-25. 6 rings. That man has been a part of a couple of them as an assistant coach, Jeff Munkin. They have not been in the playoffs since 2005. And right now, they're reeling a bit, David. They were in control in that first half. Now they're stunned a little bit.
Yeah, they really have been stunned here in the second half. But, you know, they knew they were going to have to weather the storm, too. Now we'll see if offensively they get anything going. 2-3 and outs to start this second half is not what they wanted to do.
Casey Redford. Fielded around the 10-yard line is Lauren Scott. Breaking free. Look at Scott. Shifting into fifth gear and out of bounds. 59 yards on the return for Lauren Scott.
Special teams again. They've been benefiting from great field position all game long. And here is Scott adding to that total right here by busting up a kickoff return for big time yardage. Boy, that'll get momentum going back your way in a hurry.
A dangerous return man. And so far in this second half, Georgia Southern cannot complain about their field position. They have had excellent looks, but their first two drives in that third quarter were 3 and out. Shaw goes to the air through the hands of Brian Wilshire. Tommy Irvin knocked that out of his hands. Irvin, an NFL prospect, he laid the leather on that one.
Now that's what a safety's supposed to do. And that time Wofford brought a corner fire. That means Irving's got that responsibility. The corner blitzes, he plays over the top, and that's a way to lay a lick on somebody.
Second down. Shaw with a quick.
Watch what he does. Times it perfectly. He knows he's in a bind. They got two receivers on one. He accelerates, makes a read, and then makes the hit.
First and 10 for the Eagles from Statesboro, Georgia. Jaybo Shaw Goes forward for a gain of four.
Only 205, 210 pounds right now. He's going to start to fill out, but he's a guy that can run. He's got a 6'3" frame, and he's playing one of those inside linebacker spots. Boy, that's someone they can build this thing around for years to come.
Shaw looks to the sidelines. Robert Brown hiding behind him in that three-point stance. He is low. Brown takes it, runs right into a mid Paul. There's Paul, the defensive player of the year in the Southern Conference. Third down now for the Eagles.
Watch Paul right here. He's going to penetrate the line of scrimmage, shed a block, and look at him make that play. One, two, three, four, five gold helmets around the football.
So it's third down. We'll call it 8 yards. Georgia Southern 4 for 8 on third downs today. That was one of David's keys today. How would they do on third down? Shaw with time. Throws it out of bounds. He had Robert Brown open, but he threw it out, stops the clock, 10:49 to play, and here comes the field goal team.
Great discipline by the Wofford defense right there, staying at home, knowing they had big yardage to pick up a first down. They tried to get someone out on a wheel route. They pressured the quarterback, forced an errant throw.
37-yard field goal try now for Adrian Mora, 2 for 3 today. Make it 3 for 4. Mora with a clutch kick extends the lead back to 10. Again, snap very good. Hold was perfect. Kicker liked it, and the coach, oh yeah, we needed that. Georgia Southern answers the Wofford field goal with one of their own by Adrian Mora. It's now 23-13. Lots of time to play in the fourth quarter. As we look at the rest of the FCS quarterfinals, Delaware tops New Hampshire. That was last night. Pat Devlin did his Joe Flacco impersonation. Pretty good quarterback.
Yeah, they've had a few out of there. Richie Gannon, also one of the guys coming out of Delaware. And you see Villanova upsets number one Appalachian State 42-24. I tell you what, the two-time defending national champs are out of the picture. It's anyone's ball game.
App State goes down at home. Three-time defending national champion. That had to hurt today for the home crowd. Another short kick that goes out of bounds. That hurts. That's Billy Greer. Inexplicably just, it was a duck hook out of bounds.
Yeah, it was.
Illegal kick out of bounds on the kicking team. The ball will be spotted at 40-yard line, first down.
Each one of these teams' kickers have taken a turn at that. And now that gives Wofford excellent field position again, and see if they keep things going, the momentum in the second half of play here. Their first drive went 12 plays, that second drive 17 plays, so they're starting to grind away at things.
So here comes Mitch Allen and the Terriers. Good numbers for Allen, 7 for 10. And last drive, Brenton Burson missed a touchdown grab off the fingertips. Running back Mike Rucker laid it out there. First and 10 from the 40. Timeout Wofford. Wade Lang, longtime offensive coordinator, called for that timeout, and here comes Mitch Allen to the sidelines, young man from Cincinnati, Ohio. Remember, the 2010 NCAA Women's Volleyball Championship begins Thursday, December 16th, 7 Eastern. It's live on ESPN2. It'll be in high def. And for more information on the NCAA Women's Volleyball Championship, go to the NCAA.com, the official online home for all 88 NCAA championships. Yeah, Young man enjoying himself here at Gibbs Stadium. And let's look at some of the names you might not remember played in FCS school. Walter Payton, Jerry Rice.
Wow, remember the numbers Jerry Rice was putting up at Mississippi Valley State? Unbelievable. We talked about Flacco, Kurt Warner. Look at that, Miles Austin, Tony Romo.
Terrell Owens, Chattanooga. Also a pretty good basketball player at Chattanooga. First and 10 after the timeout. Pitch back to Rucker. And Allen took another shot, but just hops right back up.
You got to be one tough cookie to run this offense at quarterback, because a lot of teams want to take out the quarterback from doing anything. Look at the lick he takes again. Took a brutal one in the first half as well. That was from Josh Rowe.
Second down and 5. Allen will keep it himself.
Number 9, Allen on the carry.
He's right at the mark.
Number 41, John Stephenson on the stop.
For 39 yards.
A lot of credit by Wade Lang, offensive coordinator. Look at the pressure coming in Allen's face again. Enough air on the football, but look at 6'4" does you out on the edge against a 5'9" Laren Scott.
Burson is a Charlotte kid, just about 70 miles from Spartanburg.
The previous play is under review.
They want to make sure that Burson held on to that football at the end of the play. And the replays that you were watching at home is what they're watching in the review booth.
You see Burson go up, has secured, it's secured, it's down, it's cradled. That one is a catch. Remember, rule the catch on the field. They need indisputable video evidence to overturn any sort of call.
Those are the two looks, and I think that last look showed that he got his hands underneath it and cradled that football.
That's a catch, and you know, Coach Ayers has to credit Wade Lang again, how
for 99 yards, and he does have one touchdown. Mike Ayers has been chomping that gum and blowing bubbles. Years.
After review, the ruling on the stand on the field stands as called. First down.
All right, Dave Epperly gave us that call, the referee from the Big South Conference. There's a good look at Brenton Burson. First and 10, ball's on the 12-yard line. Lots of time. Gets maybe a yard. Brent Russell wins that battle again. Boy, Russell's one of those guys, Dave. When you look in his face mask, he's got the mustache. I mean, he looks like a football player. He's a mean hombre.
Well, he's a fire plug in the middle there. He holds his ground. He's not going to give an inch. Plays a great leverage. Look at the passing yards by these teams, huh? especially Wofford.
Carlos Cave, along with Roderick Tinsley.
Like a rhino charging forward, turning sideways. A little lightness on his feet, too, in the middle.
Third down and eight. And keeps it. Gets down to the three.
A fake up to Brian Stein. Look at this hole right here. Look at the alley he has to run with. Again, the tucks it north and south. Cover up that football.
Fourth down and one. They are 3 for 3 on fourth down conversions. My money's on Brian Stein. I'm just telling you right now, David. Quarterback keeps it himself and gets stopped. That is a huge stop for Georgia Southern. Let's see where they mark the football. No signal yet from the referee.
They are short of that mark. And I tell you what, it's been tough sledding up inside against Brent Russell, Roderick Tinsley. Not even close. Watch what these guys are doing right here in the middle. They're creating a pile. Linebackers are filling. Look, there is nowhere to go. The only success they've had is on the edge, on the tackle here against this drive. They call it right up the gut, but Georgia Southern's
going in the bottom of that pile. Josh Rowe. He was not going to let go of Mitch Allen. Allen with the headsets on. He knows that he'll get another opportunity. Defense now tries to get the ball back. Jaybo Shaw falls forward, picks up maybe two. This has been a slow go for this Eagles offense in the second half.
I mean, after you go seven plays, position once again to start that offensive drive, but certainly Georgia Southern's defense answered the call as they started to do here in the second half.
We see Mike Nyam along with Blake Wiley.
Third down.
Time is no longer an ally of the Terriers as it continues to tick down.
And think of what this defense has done here in the second half. Two punts and held them to a field goal. Only a field goal in the second half. They've got to find a way to stop him right here. Force him to punt. Get your offensive football back.
Third down and seven. Would they dare put it up in the air? I don't think so. Pitch back. J.J. Wilcox tripped up. Let's see where that mark is. That is a first down.
What a run by J.J. Wilcox as Tommy Irvin, the All-Southern Conference. Safety up one-on-one in the hole. He's got to make that tackle. Wilcox makes a miss, and that's the difference between fourth down and first down. Advantage Georgia Southern.
New set of downs for the Eagles. Led 20-3 at halftime. Robert Brown loses the football. It's alive on the ground. It's picked up. It's a touchdown, Wofford. Alex Goldring. Where did that ball come?
Look at the guys, how fired up can you be? And it's Robert Brown again on the carry. Look at the effort, fighting for extra yards. But the one thing he forgets is ball security as Wofford's defense begins raking the ball. They're there to recover the fumble, taking it for six.
Watch Brown, looking good until the very end. The strip, the score. Well, Robert Brown had positive yards, David. About a 7-yard gain, but that extra effort gave Wofford an extra chance to strip the football.
Well, you love the effort, you love the heart, but you got to know the situation. Where Georgia Southern go 3-and-out, 4-and-out, and now their defense comes up with another huge play, this time for points.
Alex Goldtree.
For Wofford too. Again, this will be the worst field position I think Georgia Southern's had, definitely in the second half, maybe the
there's Anthony Cardin. Jabo Shaw and company. The good news for the Eagles, they still have a 3-point lead despite all the excitement.
Boy, they have a 3-point lead, but it doesn't feel like it right now, does it? As the crowd here for Wofford is coming alive, their defense is fired up, they're inspired, and they've got a chance right now. They've got to get one more stop right here, get their offense the ball back.
Shaw, the junior from Flowery Branch, Georgia. His dad's a high school coach there. Transfer from Georgia Tech. Experience at quarterback. That's what delivers a bullet.
Watch the pressure that the Wofford defense brings. Look at the protection, though. Allows their quarterback, Shaw, to set his feet, deliver the football. And there's Irvin there a little too late to make the play. Critical conversion for Georgia Southern as the clock continues to tick.
The Terriers defense needs to get another stop. They did it back in October. Eric Eberhardt on the tackle for Wofford, but again, that clock now under 3 minutes. There's Brown, the man who, well, you can't fault his effort on that play that he fumbled. He just wouldn't go down, but he left the football exposed, Dave.
Yeah, the only turnover of the game for Georgia Southern. We'll see if it turns out to be costly or not.
Both teams have touchdowns from returned fumbles. Shaw loses a couple. James Zotto got in there. There you see number 11 messed up that play.
11-94. Paul and Zotto again there to stop that option attack of Georgia Southern.
Wofford calls timeout with 2:22 to play. The storyline today, turnovers have been huge. First quarter, followed a loose football, led to a touchdown.
And this one right here, Georgia Southern, Douglas able to pick it up, scoop and score. Advantage Georgia Southern. Fumbles, and now it's Wofford's chance to pick it up, scoop and score. And it was Goltree on the play again to narrow the lead of Georgia Southern. It's 23-20, a little over 2 minutes left in this ball game. Third down again for Georgia Southern.
Jeff Munkin, 43 years old, first season as head coach of the Eagles. On the other sideline, Mike Ayers has been coaching for 40 years, 23 here in Spartanburg. Third down and 10. Shaw straight back. Keeps it himself flagged down. That'll be a hold. Or perhaps a face mask. We'll have to check. Goltree on the stop. He might have grabbed the face mask.
Boy, it's close. I can't tell. I thought I saw a tug take place, or it's also in the area where holding could be the call.
Personal foul.
Wow, what a penalty. Goltree, who returned that fumble for the score, grabs the face mask and keeps the drive alive.
I thought I saw the head of Jabo Shaw go down just a little as he is scrambling. Boy, you want to talk about a critical penalty. The first one of this second half for the Wofford Terriers.
Robert Brown is covering up the ball.
Let's look to see if we can find this face mask again. Great coverage in the second half by the Wofford Terriers defense. And there's Shaw again running with the football. There is no face mask there at all. I don't know how that call was made. That's not even close. The tug I saw was the arms around the ball and the body that forced his body down. Wow.
Well, that was a missed call. Yard penalty. Wow, it was definitely not against Jabo Shaw.
No, it was not, and not even close to being there, unless someone had hands in the face somewhere away from the football. We didn't see it, but the flag was thrown right in the vicinity.
Yeah,
there
right
where
at the
tackle was made.
So Mike Harris calls his second timeout with 1 minute to play. It'll be third down. just under a minute to play to perhaps tie or maybe win this thing. That is actually Mike's third. He did call one early in this half.
Yep.
So he is done. Eastern Washington in the second quarter leads North Dakota State in the FCS Championship quarterfinal on the red turf.
Those two teams battling it out.
So for Wofford, no timeouts. This is it. They got to stop them here.
Yeah, this is it. This is the game right here.
This is the ball game. Very similar to the way it wrapped up in Statesboro. Wofford's defense came up with a stop. Can they do it again? Jaybo Shaw gets stopped about 3 yards shy that mark. So it'll bring up fourth down. And they are in no hurry to kick that football.
No, that clock is going to continue to tick, too. How about this situation? You talked about Jeff Monken. Again, his first season as a head coach, trying to a young buck coming up against a wily vet, and he has a chance to put this game away if they manage this time correctly.
Well, David, I'm still a bit bewildered by that face mask penalty that kept this drive going.
Miffed.
Even if it was on a lineman who were battling it out, hand-to-hand combat there. South Carolina, the home of the Wofford Terriers. Doug Bell alongside David Diaz Infante, longtime member of the Denver Broncos, and we have seen a wild comeback here for Wofford in this second half. Mike Ayers, their coach of 23 years, has gone for it on fourth down three times, but it looks like, David, he may be running out of time.
Yeah, and look at the big wins Georgia Southern's had. We talked about this Appalachian State win in overtime, really gave their team a new sense of confidence, momentum that they have carried out and all the way through to here today as they got off to the quick start early on Wofford. What turns out to be the difference in the ballgame.
The winner of this game, and right now looks like Georgia Southern is in the catbird seat, will advance to the semifinals to play at Delaware next Saturday. Charlie Edwards, the best punter in the Southern Conference, one of the best in the country, boots it away quickly. Fair catch called for by Brent Burson. So with 8 seconds to go and no timeouts, the Terriers need to come up with a miracle for Georgia Southern. Look at the crowd. This was their first trip to the playoffs in 5 years, and now they smell it. We've won it 6 times. David, they want another one. They can feel it. You can feel the energy.
And they know what it's like to win it all. And certainly it looks like they're going to have a chance to go on and do just that.
Georgia Southern has defensive backs all the way back to the 50-yard line. Mitch Allen has gone the distance in the second half after getting dinged up in the first half. They're going to bounce it around. He was past the line of scrimmage when he let it go.
It's a lateral.
And that'll end the game. Georgia Southern has come into Spartanburg.
After the game.
Illegal foul pass on the offense. Penalties on the field. Game is over.
And the Eagles have advanced to the semifinals. With a sign of good sportsmanship and appreciation, both teams have had tremendous years, David, but it's the Eagles who'll get to play one more week.
Yeah, they go through the season 9-4. They win here and they go forward, and they'll be facing Delaware in the semifinals.
Villanova with a stunning upset at Appalachian State earlier today. They await the winner of Eastern Washington or North Dakota State. And for the Eagles, Thousands made the trek over from Statesboro. They're on the field and celebrating. Once again, our final score, Georgia Southern 23, Wofford 20. Georgia Southern advances to the FCS Championship semifinal. The proceeding has been an exclusive Spartanburg, South Carolina, where the Eagles of Georgia Southern are soaring.